Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Okay, a couple things that we're going to get started with are definitions. One is the meridian, and that is the line that divides the sky into eastern and western halves by going from the point further south all the way overhead to the zenith and then to the point directly north. So it's an imaginary line, and you can find that by opening up the sky and viewing options window on Stellarium. Go to the markings tab and then click on meridian right here. Boom, and there it shows up, this line that splits the sky into two. And you see that I have an object that is very close to that, just on the eastern side of it, and that's because that object is very close to what's called culmination. And that word is sometimes confused with aligning the mirrors of a reflector telescope. That's collimation, and they're very close words, so I understand why people get confused with that. But culmination means when an object reaches its highest point above the horizon as the Earth is spinning and as it's going across the sky. So this object is very close to culmination because it's very close to the meridian. And you can see how that works if you bring up the equatorial grid. You'll notice how these lines kind of go this way, and they're at their highest point near the meridian. So this object would start down here by the horizon, come up, hit culmination, and then go back down before it sets. So those are important to know because this object is fairly low in the sky. If we take off the equatorial grid and go to the azimuthal grid, you can see that this is 20 degree line right here. This object is only about 25 degrees or so high for me, and that's a problem because much lower than about 15 degrees or so, and it's going to be really hard to see. Plus, we have another issue, and that is the fact that the days are getting shorter, so evening is occurring as the sun sets later. You can see if I back this up just an hour to 6 o'clock, I've still got light here. So if I go to 7 o'clock, I'm already close to culmination, and I need to be viewing that object about an hour or so. Well, it's more than an hour after sunset, but it's dark, and the object is very close to where it's going to be at. And then if I go past that, I can still see it at 8 o'clock. That's okay. But once I get to 9 o'clock, it's starting to drop fairly significantly, and then we're getting into some light pollution. That's going to be an even bigger deal for my friends who live up further north of me, because I'm at about 40 degrees north latitude. If you're at 50 or 55 or even 60, 65 degrees north latitude. Well, 65, you probably won't see this object at all. But if you're at 55, instead of being 25 degrees high, it's only going to be about 10 degrees high, which is going to put it really low in your sky. So you're going to need very transparent skies, and you're going to want to look at it when it's at culmination, if you can even see it. So what is this object? Well, it's Messier 79, which is in the constellation of Lepus, which I highlighted in a Twitter and Facebook post a couple days ago. And that particular constellation is not difficult to find because if we bring up all of our constellation lines, we can see that Orion is right here towards the south, and Lepus is right underneath the line. It's also directly west of where Sirius is in Canis Major. And that's actually an interesting constellation to bring up as well because Messier 79 is a globular cluster that perhaps actually was not part of our original Milky Way galaxy, but rather came from the Canis Major dwarf galaxy, and that our Milky Way galaxy kind of grabbed onto gravitationally. Now that's a little bit contentious, but there's a possibility that that is where this particular globular cluster came from. So that's an interesting bit of science behind it. The good thing is, it's not too hard to track down and find. So how do we do that? Well, if we take away a couple of our lines and things here, we can take away the meridian, we can take away our azimuthal grid, and just actually even take away our constellation lines because this shouldn't be too difficult. We zoom in on this area, and here's Rigel and Saiph from Orion. There's the belt stars. We just drop down and we can get to Arneb, which is Alpha Leporis right here. And if we follow that line along towards our southern horizon, we're going to see another fairly bright star. That's Nihal, which is Beta Leporis. It's a 2.8 magnitude star. So these are not too difficult to see, 2.6 and 2.8 magnitude. You may have more difficulty seeing the rest of Lepus as these start to be third and fourth magnitude stars that kind of round out the hair shape, especially these tail stars, but these are the bright ones, fortunately, are the ones we want to look at. So we're going to go from alpha to beta, and we're just going to continue right on in that direction. And that's where Messier 79 is. Now, if we zoom in just a little bit more, we can see that we've got a couple more stars that are going to help us. So if we start at Nihal, and we know that we're going away from Arneb, we've got this star, which is a sixth magnitude star, which we should be able to see in a finder scope field of view because it's not very far away. If we bring up our measuring tool, we can see how this is only 40 or so arc minutes away, so less than a degree, you'll be able to see those stars. Just don't get confused with this star over here, which is going to be a similar brightness, and don't use this star over here, which is a little bit brighter. Follow that line from Arneb to Nihal, which, by the way, when we click our measuring tool back off, if we center those, we can see that in the middle of that, those stars are only about 3 degrees away. So you can actually put all of those, or both of those, including this star, into the same field of view because you've easily got 7 degrees that can capture all those. So that's not too difficult to do. What you're then going to do is you'll pull Arneb out of the way and follow on that line and go towards this star down here, which is, I believe, is a sixth magnitude star, and it's about 4 degrees away. So you'll have Nihal and this star in the same field of view together before it's centered. I'm sorry, that's a fifth magnitude star, so that's even easier to see. And then center that star. And once you do that, well, Messier 79 is very close by. So if we bring that up in our finder scope view, actually, we'll do that from Nihal. So this is your reversed field of view as if looking through a typical finder scope. You can see how we've got Arneb and Nihal together. We just follow these along, follow to here. Notice how when we bring Nihal further down, we've got this star that then comes into our field of view. That's our target star. And then right nearby, there's Messier 79, not too difficult to find and see. When we bring up a higher magnification, there is the globular cluster right there. That's about a, oh, 3/4 of a degree field of view at about 75 magnification. You'll want to put additional magnification on this because the globular cluster itself, and for some reason my stellarium doesn't actually have it centered, but the globular cluster itself is only about 8 arc minutes across. So that's not terribly large. And remember, that's the full distance across. So you're maybe going to see 3 to 4 arc minutes of that. So it's a fairly small, tight cluster. Not horribly bright either. This is eighth magnitude with a surface brightness of 12.5. That's getting kind of dim. So you will have to look for it fairly intently. Maybe use some averted vision techniques. And again, wait for the cluster to be at about culmination. So look for Arneb and Nihal to be at their highest points directly due south, and then start looking for the cluster about that time. So that's how we can find Messier 79. And that's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies. And don't forget to like me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter or even on my Instagram account. I'm going to have a lot more content coming up over the next year, and I hope that you'll share those things and also help other people find things in the night sky to see the wonderful objects around us in our universe. Thanks.